Thank you. I will call Dr. Stefan Johansson for the last presentation of the day. Family-based neonatal care. At the end of the presentation, Dr. Johansson will show you a video, 3 minutes video, related to that topic. Thank you.
Thank you very much for the introduction, and it's always challenging to have the last session of a long day, and I would like to thank you all for staying for this long. So I would like to speak about family-based neonatal care, and because it's a subject that is close to my heart, and I also believe that it's one of the least utilized effective interventions to improve neonatal outcomes. So I would like to quote again the American Academy of Pediatrics. They have work or task forces for everything, also the family. And they write that families are the most central and enduring influence in children's lives. And when it comes to family-centered care, there is also an organization that works with the so-called theoretical framework around family-centered care. And I think they put it nicely that it's related to the way we provide health care and that it is grounded in mutually beneficial partnerships with families. There's also quite a lot of research on family-based care, and I would like to recommend reading of the Poppy project in the UK. They have done their own research, but they also summarized quite a lot of their research being done in other sites and countries. But I also believe that most of you are clinicians, so you work in units and you meet a lot of babies and parents, and I guess that you also may have boards like this where parents put up their photos of their ex-preemies and so on. I think it reminds ourselves why we are doing all what we do. Becoming a parent is, as I think many of you also have experienced, it's a life-changing event. And I think that we as parents have a lot of preconceptions and expectations and demands on ourselves as parents. But one thing most parents-to-be are not aware of is that the probability of ending up in the NICU is about 10%. That's the figure in Sweden, at least. And becoming a NICU parent is very challenging for many parents. They are unprepared. They have never heard about the neonatal intensive care unit. They feel that they lose control. They may feel guilty about, they may be accusing themselves for what's happened. Many parents are afraid, and of course they also worry about the future of their infant. And I think we can learn a lot of how we work from parents. This is a blog post by a British writer titled Inside the Barbaric World of an Neonatal Unit. And as she writes in the lower half, she writes, "I felt like I had been transported to an alien world. Everyone kept saying how wonderful it was, how amazing the care was, and I admit the nurses were mostly kind and caring, but a wonderful place. No, I found it to be the most barbaric environment I have ever been subjected to." Very strong experience communicated. There are research on what NICU parents would like to have when they come to the NICU. They want to have information, and they want to have a sense of inclusion. They want to be able to, as they do in the maternity ward or at home, they want to feel that they can protect their baby and to be close to their baby. And they also want to be positively perceived by staff. And there are a lot of strategies we could apply to support what parents want to do. We can give emotional support, have a welcoming atmosphere, have supportive unit policies, and also educate parents what everything is all about. So when I boil down what is family-based practice in, for me, it's about parents being a natural part of the team around the baby, and that parents could be present as caregivers, that they are participating in ward rounds, that we encourage them to be skin to skin, and that we try to room parents in the unit. I will come back to that later. I would also like to say that contexts are different, and there is no size that fits all with regard to family-based care, and I think we all need to find our own way to practice family-based neonatal care. Now, do we need evidence for family-based neonatal care before we can adopt it? Well, my personal opinion is that we don't need regular evidence, meaning large, randomized, placebo-controlled trials, etc. But actually, there are quite a number of randomized trials on family-based care, and I will go through just the main results from five of the of relatively recent family-based trials. The first one is called the COPE trial, where families to preterm infants were randomized to either learn about infant behavior and how to parent it, or they had lectures about hospital services and organizations, which is not so interesting for most parents. And this research group could show that families in the empowered group had lower depression and anxiety scores at discharge, and they also, the babies had a four-day shorter stay of care. The Stockholm Family Centered Care Study also randomized a relatively large number of families. Those families were randomized to be roomed in in the NICU, or they were staying at home and commuting, coming to and from the NICU. And this study showed that the family care families also had less anxiety at discharge, and it also prevailed until 3 months after discharge. And the hospital stay was almost 1 week shorter for the family care group. This is a trial on parental presence in NICU rounds. It's a relatively small trial from the UK. And they used a crossover design, so all parents were their own control. So they participated in ward rounds, and then during the next period they did not participate in ward rounds. And very briefly, almost all the parents and the vast majority of staff concluded from the questionnaires they wrote afterwards that parents should be allowed to attend rounds. They also did focus group interviews after the intervention, and the group interviews revealed two central themes: communication, that parents wanted and needed communication, and the second theme was philosophy, that this was the right thing to do. The fourth example is a nurture intervention, in which parents were, one group of parents were randomized to learn calming interactions with their babies. So they were scent cloths, so the baby could smell the smell of their parent, of his or her parents. They were learned how to touch and vocally soothe the baby, and they also encouraged skin-to-skin contact in the intervention group. And at 18 months, they looked at the Bayley score in these two groups, and the nurtured infants had higher Bayley scores, and they also had fewer attention problems on the CBCL, and also higher scores on the MCHAT. Finally, an example from our neighboring country, Norway, where parents were randomized to do physiotherapy twice a day over 10 minutes over 3 weeks. And when blinded physiotherapists judged the motor performance at 37 weeks, the physiotherapy treated or parent treated infants were judged to have a more mature motor performance. So what does data tell us? Well, the upside is that there doesn't seem to be any side effects of parental care. The other finding is that associations are consistently positive, but the scientific downside is, of course, that most of these studies are relatively small, maybe coming up to a few hundred babies, and I am sure there are a lot of bias in those studies due to the non-blinding problem. And we don't know anything about the long-term results. On the other hand, we could also ask ourselves whether non-family-based care is an acceptable strategy today. I would like to say something about the journey in Stockholm, which started at the Karolinska University Hospital and spread also to the other hospitals in Stockholm. This was something that started about 15 years ago, and it's still a work in progress, I would say. And during this time period, we have had a lot of staff engagement, and we have also been thinking a lot about how we organize our wards. And if we renovate or build a new ward, we think about family-based care a lot, how families could be present, etc., etc. We also needed to look into strategies and guidelines for, well, virtually everything, I would say. And since we have a lot of mothers and we want all mothers to express their own breast milk, we also need strategies and processes for handling a lot of breast milk in the NICU. And most importantly, we have needed to adopt a mindset of being educators and coaches for families. And this is how we work. We aim for non-separation. So we aim not to separate the baby from the parents unless it's really needed. We also encourage early skin-to-skin, in principle, as soon as possible, meaning first hour at least. And if we think about a common example, a preterm baby that is born by cesarean section, it is usually the father who is the first parent to sit skin to skin with the baby because the mother is in the post-op, etc. We want to do ward rounds with parents, and we want them to stay in the NICU, in the family rooms. And when the baby is off CPAP and so on, we want the baby to stay with the parents in the family room with wireless monitoring and so on. And finally, we also use home care. So when the baby is on tube feeding and practicing breastfeeding, we usually discharge the baby and we have nurses coming home to the parents instead of the family stays with us. Unless you have tried to do ward rounds with parents, it's something I can really recommend because I think it improves the empowerment. Parents feel much more secure and able to do a lot of other things. And I also believe that it increases transparency towards the parents, that we work together with parents and in front of them. They are not questioning what we are doing so much. I also believe it improves decision-making because parents, if you hear what the parents report about the baby, they also commonly have more information than the nurses sometimes. And I also believe it improves the planning of care, and it also saves time because you round the baby and speak to the parent at once, and then you go off to the next family. So you don't need to go back to parents all the time and speak to them after the round. Those headphones is something that we use in the intensive care rooms because there are usually lots of parents present. So all the other parents that we're not doing the rounds with, they listen to radio while we have round with one baby. My personal reflections about family-based care is that I think it improves our professional relationships with parents. And it's also interesting, we all know that most people, not like us, but one is constantly reminded about that. It's also a good way to work because you can communicate your expectations to the parents. So you sort of work on the same track with families. Naturally, hygiene guidelines are essential, and we have also needed to apply some visiting policies for relatives. And we also need to remember that while parents are part of the team, we, as medical professionals, have the medical responsibilities. We take the decisions. Finally, I would just like to say that family-based care is not about being nice to parents. I think we should see parents as a medical intervention because there are quite a lot of data showing that parental care and the relationships that develops with parents can be very important for the development of the baby, and especially preterm babies. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Stephen. Yes, please.
Do we have time?
Yeah. Do you have time?
It's only a 3-minute film.
Tweak you up, guys.
So I just would like to show a film. It's about 2.5 minutes, and it's a colleague who is interviewing parents in a family room. They had preterm twins that were 33 weeks, and they are going home after 1.5 week. Let's see if we can hear something.
Hello.
Hello. Hello.
How are your babies today?
Good. Eating. Sleeping.
Eating.
Yes.
How many weeks have you been here?
A little bit more than 1 week.
A little more than 1 week.
Yeah.
And in what week were your babies born?
34.
Week 34.
Yeah, 34
yes.
Plus 5.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you are tube feeding your babies now?
Yes, it's a little bit of a mixture between the tube feeding and breastfeeding.
Okay.
So they're slowly learning how to do it.
And I've been told that you soon will go home and keep on tube feeding and breastfeeding at home.
Yeah, trying to find some sort of balance between the tube and breastfeeding.
Okay.
Yeah.
Has you both parents been sleeping here?
Yeah. We have two older siblings at home.
So, yes.
Your 1 year has been home with them during the nights.
Okay.
And I've been here, and then you've been trying to come here as much as possible.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And you are taking care of your babies all the time, changing diapers,
yeah,
cleaning the baby, feeding the baby.
We're doing as much as possible.
As much as
possible. Trying to prepare for what it will be like coming home with the babies.
Okay.
So trying to be as natural as possible, nursing them and feeding them.
Okay.
And then with the support from the staff here, of course.
Yes.
During nights and trying to get some sleep. We realize that we won't have too much sleep during the upcoming months, so trying to get some rest every now and then as well.
And then you have the pump here to stimulate your milk.
Yep.
And your babies have been starting to breastfeed.
Yeah.
Very nice.
They're learning. Goes a bit slowly if you compare to the older kids that are
of course
born in week 39, but still they're very capable.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Good luck with your babies. Soon we will have the medical round with the Dr. Stefan Johansson. Okay.
Okay, thanks.
This is just what it looks like. We have a portable computer with an electronic patient record system. So we, the doctor and the nurse, go into the room and do the ward round, all the paperwork, speak to the parents, investigate the baby, everything at once. And when you know the parents and the baby, this type of ward round, it takes like 10 minutes per baby or so. It's very time efficient, I would say. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Jensen. And the floor is now open. We can take maybe one or two or three questions because we don't have much of time. Yes, Dr. Fahed, you start, please.
Thank you very much for the home, the family-centered unit. But there was a concern now about patients or babies who are not visited, and they are alone in the room. So some recommendation are talking about the putting the baby in a single room if the parents are not there. And it can delay the speech or delay the language on the on that babies. Do you have come across these?
Yes, that happens sometimes. And we try to communicate from day one that we expect parents to be present in the NICU every day, both parents. And but sometimes parents have other children or they live far away and so on. But I mean, the whole concept that we work with includes that parents are present. So we try to work out practical solutions with the social worker, et cetera, et cetera. But as you say, sometimes it's challenging to have the setup working. That's the case also.
Next question. Yes, please, Dr. Nimri.
Yes, thank you, Stephen. For BDA, we're still confused to treat or not to treat until now. Recently, we have some paper talking about cardiac enzymes as a predictors for the significant severities of the BDA. Yeah. They fed out. It went out, and nobody is practicing it.
Yeah, I'm not aware of people practicing it, like the antinatriuretic peptide, for example. And I think that, I believe that most units have echocardiography available because neonatologists nowadays learn to do echoes. It's quite common in Sweden, at least. And when you can look at the duct directly instead of using indirect measures, that's definitely preferable. The problem is that you need to decide what is a significant duct. In Sweden, we have a general guideline about certain measurements that we should be doing, and if it's above or below certain numbers, we consider it to be significant.
I still believe in the trials of the TIBS trials and the emphysema prophylaxis and the values of preventing a lot of pulmonary hemorrhage secondary to the duct. Some of us still practicing giving endomethacin early as prophylaxis, some not.
Yeah.
I don't know what's the new trend now in your side.
I think with regard to the duct, I don't think, the duct closes in a large significant of those, in large proportion of those babies. And my personal opinion is that endomethacin prophylaxis is not a bad strategy because it is nicely demonstrated that it reduces the risk of severe IVH. And although they could not show major benefits in the long term, I believe that it's still a good thing to achieve to have fewer severe IVH.
In your unit?
We don't.
We don't?
No.
Why? You don't have IVH?
It's a long... I think... that you agree that treating ducts is a controversial topic also in units, and we have a lot of controversies about this. We are now updating the protocol, and we have such a big argument about this, what we should be doing and why and so on.
Hmm.
Can I just comment on that? Because like Stefan, we are also not using the prophylactic indomethacin, but perhaps for a different reason. Because the American trials that did show a benefit as far as IVH had a much greater rate of IVH in the premies than we had in our NICU. So we felt that there was no way that we could transfer those data and that interpretation to our setting without doing a completely new trial.
The rate was high. Yeah. The rate was very high.
Yes, yes.
Or? Yes, please.
Thank you very much for this presentation. But as you said, because most of meta-analysis failed to prove the benefit of closing BDA, especially early, why not to leave this baby alone? Why we conducting a lot of study to give ibuprofen, to give indomethacin, a lot of studies conducted? Why not to leave them and use another criteria which predict this baby will go for adverse, effect?
Oh, thank you. It's a very good and relevant question, of course. To begin with, I think in terms of study size, most of the previous randomized trials have been relatively small. I mean, if you want to answer a question, even though it's a relatively common problem, you typically need at least 1,000 babies to be randomized, and there are no studies of that size. And so I think it's one problem is the statistical power to detect differences. And the other question is whether treatment really changes the outcomes. Because when Cochrane concludes that we should be using ibuprofen instead of indomethacin because of a lower risk of NEC, that is actually referring to the side effect of NEC from treatment. That's at least how I interpret the data. So we cannot be certain that treatment is not associated with bad outcomes. And I think that's why I think it's so important to be brave enough to make a randomized treatment trial that also includes placebo. On the other hand, there are data suggesting, like the two recent papers, the one in JAMA from France and the Australian study, that early management seems to have some benefits with regard to pulmonary hemorrhages. Now, pulmonary hemorrhage is a relatively unfrequent complication, at least in our unit, but that's my prediction, that early treatment will be the norm in the future, but we really need good science to back that treatment strategy up, I think.
I would like to muddy the waters even further when it comes to indomethacin and ibuprofen, because for one thing, the meta-analyses, as Stefan just alluded to, are not all that strong, right? They're not all that convincing. Well, then comes another factor, which is that at least in my country, ibuprofen treatment costs at least 100 times the cost of treatment with ibuprofen. And then we get into the territory that health economists call marginal cost. How much extra money are you willing to pay for how much additional benefit? Now, it may not matter in wealthy countries all that much, but if you find yourself in a limited resource setting, it's not a given that ibuprofen is preferable. I just wanted to complicate matters even further.
I just want to make also a comment that we should not forget also that it's not a completely benign problem, PDA. I mean, we saw babies dying from pulmonary hemorrhage, as you mentioned, like 21% in one study. And that's why you need at least to monitor them and to decide when to treat. It's the difficulty part.
Yes, I would not like you to go home and give placebo to open ducts that you think are clearly a problem to the baby. It's just that the feeling or when you work in the NICU and you see babies that are not well, you do echoes and you see severe shunting, etc. I mean, it's a natural thing to do, is to offer treatment, even though you cannot be certain about the benefits. But I think that science need to sort of push the boundaries a little bit, and because defining the population that needs treatment, that is one of the major things for science, because I'm personally convinced that there are babies that do need treatment, I think we should be having our guidelines and strategies where we work and apply those, and that those guidelines should be including treatment, of course.
Thank you all for attending, and this is the last session. I would like to thank both professors for their great presentation, and to see you, inshallah, tomorrow at 8 a.m. Thank you.